So, good morning, students. Today we would be talking about that what are the mechanisms of transplant rejection, that how a particular draft got rejected in case a transplant is being done. In this scenario, the main learning objective of this lecture is to understand the mechanism of transplant rejection, what are the clinical manifestations, or you can say the clinical outcomes involved in mediating this graft rejection. After learning about this complete mechanism, you will be able to gain a detailed insight of all the cell mediated, antibody mediated pathways that are involved in the graft rejection and the role of T cells in mediating the rejection also. However, the main information about the various clinical reaction, hyperacute, acute or chronic infections, that will be also covered, that you know, depending upon the different time span that they usually take to reject a particular graft. So transplant rejection is found to be a major issue, because as soon as the major discoveries are happening in this transplantation scenario, it has been observed by many of the scientists all around the world that the grafts, if the particular graft that can be a organ, cell or tissue, if you receive from other individuals in normal or outbred population, they got rejected. That means we are talking about allograft. Autograft are radially accepted, but we are talking about allograft, because all of the studies, research based studies that were conducted in the year 1940 and 1950s, all the studies result outcome, it displayed that these rejection reactions, they are basically governed by the adaptive immune response. That means it is showing the phenomena of recognition, specificity and memory. However, we have discussed these things in our yesterday's lecture also. So all of these things are dependent upon adaptive immune response, and they are mainly dependent upon various kinds of lymphocytes that are involved in it. So the main evidence behind this adaptive role of adaptive immune response in this scenario is, if, as you can see, I have made a table in which there are three main tabs, that is prior exposure to donor MHC molecule lead to accelerated graft rejection. That means if the MHC molecules present onto the donor cells, if they have been exposed prior to the same graft, in that case there is a very fast response that would be mediated in case of graft rejection. That means the main, which of the adaptive immune response part would be playing the role? Memory, because of the memory cells, and specificity. That means memory and specificity are the main key mechanisms that are involved in the graft rejection. Another is, sometimes the ability to reject a graft, it can rapidly be transferred to a naive individual by administering the lymphocytes from a sensitized individual. In that case also, all the rejection of the graft is lymphocyte mediated. Suppose you are taking the lymphocyte from a sensitized person who had been exposed to the who is having exposure to that very antigen, and then you are administering the graft containing those sensitized lymphocytes. The lymphocytes against that very particular graft is already formed in the host body. In that case, the rejection of graft is completely dependent upon the lymphocytes that are circulating in the donor body. Last part is inactivation or depletion of T lymphocytes. If there is a situation in which the T lymphocytes that are being produced in response to the graft, if they are inactivated or their expression is suppressed, or they are depleted from the body by using any kind of antibodies or some drugs or medication, in that case the chances of graft rejection is reducing. That means if you want your graft to be accepted, you can use a therapy that is known as immunosuppressive therapy, in which we administer various kinds of antibodies and drugs while doing grafting, so that our graft can't be rejected and it shall be accepted with ease. So what are the attributes of specificity and memory in the case of graft rejection? because specificity and memory are the main properties of immune response that have been observed in the graft rejection. The immunological memory, that means the memory response of a body, is basically the main mechanism that is involved in the graft rejection, and we can understand this fact by taking an example. Now suppose you have an mouse variety A. There is a strain A. You are grafting this strain A from the skin taken from strain B. Both are mouse, the strains are different. From one strain we are taking the skin part and we are grafting it to the first strain. In that case, the graft rejection will take some time, will take lesser time than the first time, because the specificity of this graft rejection is basically demonstrated when along with the second time grafting from strain B to strain A. Suppose you have already done first time grafting. At that time, the response was delayed because our body was preparing for it. You can say it will take around 1 week, or it may take around 4 to 7 days. After that, if at the second time you are again grafting the same tissue from the same person to the same donor, in that case the response would be exaggerated. Why? Because of the memory response. Because while in the previous exposure, in the first exposure, the cells of the donor have created a memory response. Because of that, the second set of rejection is much faster as compared to the first set. So this is the main evidence of this specificity and memory. This is the complete thing that has been written here that I have just explained. So what is the tempo of this transplant rejection? That means, so I have listed autograft and allograft. Autograft, the most of the chances, most of the time, whenever you go for the autograft, in that case the chances of acceptance of graft is higher, because we are taking self tissues. In that case, what are the consequences? What is the timeline? If you are taking an autograft, in that case, within 3 to 7 days, revascularization would be happening. After 7 to 10 days, healing would be starting, and 12 to 14 days, resolution would be happening. But if you are going for allograft rejection in first step, as I have told you, that if you are taking skin from one mouse to another mouse, this would be the first exposure. In that case, within 3 to 7 days, revascularization would be happening. As I told you, whenever the first time exposure is being given, at that time it may take some time because our body is adapting, or our body is preparing against that very graft. So after 7 to 10 days, what would be happening? Cellular infiltration of lymphocytes, monocytes and neutrophils. Now, what do you mean by this term? Cellular infiltration. What would be happening at the site of grafting? All of these lymphocytes, monocytes, neutrophils, they would be start accumulating. After 10 days, when they have accumulated in the large amount, they will be promoting thrombosis and necrosis, and your graft would be rejected. It would change to a necrotic tissue. But in case the same organism is exposed to the same for the second time graft from the same donor one, in that case this revascularization step would be omitted, because this revascularization step in the first case was our body preparation. But in the second case, the body is already prepared, because we are having a very good mechanism of immunological memory. So because of this memory response, this revascularization won't be happening. As soon as the second grafting is being done, directly this very step, cellular infiltration of lymphocytes, monocytes, neutrophils, this would be happening at the site of grafting. After that, within 7 to 10 days, the tissue would be necrotic. So whatever I have told you, revascularization, healing, resolution. So I am first of all taking example of autograftings. We will be explaining this thing. We will be discussing this thing with a diagram also. So autografting, as we know, this is a classical example of graft acceptance, in which we are transferring self tissue from one body site to another body site. Because of the similar genetic homology, the chances of immune rejection is 0%, because our immune system won't try to respond against our own tissues. In most of the cases, this autografting is being performed in the case of skin graft, bone marrow transplantation, stem cell transplantation, synthetic implantation. So what are the steps? As I've told you in the previous slide also, autograft acceptance. First is, suppose you are making a skin graft. So these are blood vessels, these are pink ones. This is a grafted epidermis. So within 3 to 7 days, the first step is revascularization. That means this grafted skin will try to, vascularize with the already disrupted blood vessels. So here you can see revascularization is being done. After 7 to 10 days, the healing will start, because for the healing we need our immune cells. For that, few neutrophils will migrate to the site. As you can see, neutrophils are shown here after revascularization. After 12 to 14 days, the resolution would be happening and your skin would be healed completely and the graft is accepted. This is happening in the case of autograft. But in the case of allograft, adaptive immune response comes into play, on which the main targets for the rejection are main three things. One is major histocompatibility complex. It can be class 1 antigen or class 2 antigen. They are the main targets. And minor histocompatibility antigens. They are also peptide derived from these polymorphic cellular proteins that are present onto the MHC class 1 protein. However, they play a very important role in the transplant rejection. They are also known as transplantation antigens. And other alloantigens. Other alloantigen corresponds to our human blood group antigen. That means we are having a ABO blood group typing. So all the antigens that are present onto the surface of A blood group, B blood group, or AB. So all of these also act as a transplantation antigen, and they are the main targets of it. So this is the schematic diagram of the process of graft acceptance and rejection by the adaptive immune response of specificity and memory. This is the autograft acceptance that I have just discussed. This is the first set rejection in case of allografting. As you can see, first set rejection, that means you are for the first time taking a tissue from donor and you are grafting that very thing into the recipient. So in the first 3 to 7 days, the step is revascularization. Revascularization is happening here, as you can see. Then after 7 to 10 days, cellular infiltration would be happening. As you can see, there is accumulation of large number of cells over here. Lymphocytes, neutrophils, macrophages, they are all accumulated here. And these large infiltration, due to this large accumulation of these cells, this grafted tissue, because all these neutrophils are basically attacking this graft. So this graft would be undergoing thrombosis and necrosis, and it would be converting to a necrotic tissue. And below this tissue, the blood clotting would be happening, because again, the blood vessels are disrupted. So this is the first set of rejection. But in this case, after the cellular infiltration, the complete process took around 15 days to reject the graft. But if in the case you again go for the second set of grafting, that means the recipient is same, the donor is same, you are again trying it, in that case this step of revascularization will not be there, because our body is already prepared for it. So as soon as you will graft the epidermis, within the 3 to 4 days, cellular infiltration step would be happening and thrombosis and necrosis would be happening, and within 7 days of span, this second set rejection would be happening there. So as you can compare between these two things, the main thing is specificity and memory that is involved in both set of rejections. So now the point is, having talked about all these things, we must know the allograft rejection mechanism. It is basically dependent upon the T cells, that means T lymphocytes. So this allograft rejection mechanism, it is mainly dependent upon T cells, and this thing was basically proven in the year of 1950 by scientist Averyon, who for the first time he gave an evidence that using an adaptive transfer experiments, that lymphocytes are the main key players whenever you are going for allograft. In that case, they are the main key players that mediate the rejection. Now, as in the previous slide also, I have taken one example of mouse strain A and mouse strain B. So the experimental demonstration of this T cells that can mediate the allograft rejection was as follows. When the T cells obtained from an allograft primed mouse, when already a mouse is, has undergone allografting, and after that you are taking T cells from that very mouse and you are transferring to a mouse, to an another species of mouse, to an another strain of mouse in which there is no grafting. So you are basically administering activated lymphocyte to the body of second mouse. In that case, the recipient will generate a second set rejection response to initial allograft from the original allogenic strain. So as you can see in this diagram, naive mouse strain A grafted with skin from strain B. It was grafted. After 14 days, first set of rejection was observed as shown in the previous slide. Then after some time, mouse strain A again grafted with the skin from strain B for the second time. So after 6 days, second set rejection is happening. If the naive mouse strain A grafted with the skin from strain B for the first time, for the first skin graft, again the second set rejection is happening. So the main step is, the main role is between the T cells, because they get activated when you try it for the first time. Now, how these T cells are basically recognizing the antigens, the alloantigens present onto the graft cells. So this recognition is basically happening in the two ways. These allogenic MHC molecule of a graft, they are presented for recognition by the recipient's T cells in the two main pathway. One is direct pathway, another is indirect pathway. In the case of direct recognition pathway, the intact MHC molecules that are displayed by the cells onto the graft, they are recognized by recipient T cells. However, they do not need any processing. Normally, what is the antigen processing and presentation pathway? First of all, the recognition of antigen is being done. Then after the antigen presenting cell process that antigen, then they go for presentation. So there is a sequence to it. But in case of direct recognition, there is no processing. They are directly recognizing it and presenting it. And the indirect pathway, it follows the proper procedure of it. That means donor MHC molecules are first of all captured. That means recognized. Then they are processed by the recipient APCs. That means the processing of those antigen is being carried out by the antigen presenting cell of the recipient body. And all the peptides or protein fragments that we are getting after processing, they are displayed by MHC class 2 molecule onto the surface of the antigen presenting cell so that the T cell can recognize. This is the general phenomena. So let's talk about it. This is the direct alloantigen recognition in which there is no processing. As you can see, this is an allogenic antigen presenting cell in graft. It is directly presenting the antigen. So this is the alloreactive T cell that is recognizing it. So it is basically recognizing unprocessed full molecule of antigen in case of direct recognition. On the other hand, there is another pathway, that is indirect, in which suppose this is the grafted tissue, this is the antigen present, this is the allogenic MHC. First of all, this antigen would be uptaken by the recipient antigen presenting cell. It would be doing the processing. This is the processing step. And after that, it will present this antigen onto its surface. Then on the surface, this antigen is being displayed, and the alloreactive T cell would be going for the recognition. So these are the two recognition pathway by T cells in the case of grafting. Now the point is, whenever the immune system of a host, it detect a foreign graft tissue, or you can say they didn't, don't want to accept that very graft. So it launches an attack system, and that will ultimately lead to tissue rejection. And this complete tissue rejection step, this basically is carried out in two stages. That is, one stage is sensitization stage and another stage is effector stage. However, in both of these stages, there are three types of clinical manifestations. That means clinical outcomes, how the graft is being rejected. What is the clinical manifestation of it? Suppose you have grafted a tissue, after how many days or after how many time, how the response would be coming? So those three clinical outcomes are there in this case. This is hyperacute, acute, and chronic. So we will be first of all discussing the stages. First of all is the stage one, that is sensitization stage, as the name suggests. In this case, the sensitization of antigen will be carried out. So the first step would be antigen recognition by the T cell, either by direct pathway or indirect pathway that I just discussed. So after the antigen recognition by this T cell, it will activate the T cell and it will undergo lymphocyte proliferation. You can say it will differentiate into different cell types, cytotoxic T cell, helper T cell, or delayed type hypersensitive T cell. Then after that, antigens that are present onto the surface of graft's HLA complex, that could be processed and presented by either of the pathway. If the indirect pathway is there, in that case the processing would be happening. If it is direct pathway, in that case this step would be omitted. Along with that, this antigen recognition step with MHC molecule, minor histocompatibility complex, they are also very important, because however they do not show exact similarity, but there are multiple, due to this multiple mismatch thing, they will trigger the rejection process, because the major histocompatibility complex, they can be recognized directly by the T cells because they are involved in the recognition and activation of T cells. But the minor histocompatibility complex, they have to undergo the step of processing and presentation by antigen presenting cells. So let's discuss this thing in more detail. Activation and effector function of this alloreactive T lymphocyte in case of sensitization stage. So after the lymphocyte is recognizing this alloantigen, it will become activated, it will proliferate, differentiate, it will, you know, perform different effector functions that can lead to the graft rejection. In this case, the donor antigen presenting cell is expressing the donor MHC molecule as well as some co-stimulator molecules. It can be B7, it can be CD28. There are many more. After recognizing this incomplete complex, they will migrate to the lymph node so that the further processing can be done. So once they have reached the lymph node and they present that thing on their surface, whether it is unprocessed molecules, onto the recipient T cells. Along with that, the host dendritic cell from the recipient, they also play a very important role while migrating into the graft, because they are also involved in recognizing these graft alloantigens, and they transport these alloantigens back by draining from the lymph node. I'll show you a picture also. So this is the co-stimulators that are involved, that is B7 molecule on the APC that is mainly involved in mitigating it. Another stage was effector stage. This is in this case, the host immune system is all ready, because in the sensitization phase, all the preparation part is being carried out. In the effector stage, the host immune system is bang on in charge, and right now they will be going for the attack, and this attack can be mediated by four different methods. First is CTL mediated cytotoxicity, that means cell mediated, you can say cytotoxic T lymphocyte mediated cytotoxicity. Another is delayed type hypersensitivity. Antibody dependent cell mediated cytotoxicity, that means ADCC, and complement mediated lysis. In our previous lectures also, we have discussed all these four mechanisms. So how they are doing it? Because once the different T lymphocytes, they have been differentiated into their effector cell, they are all in charge that now they have to go for the attack and for the destruction of this very graft cell. In this case, the CD8 positive cytotoxic T lymphocytes are the main key players, and they are either generated by direct allorecognition, that means either by the direct pathway, so that they can directly recognize the MHC molecules onto the cells present on the graft, and they kill those cells by CTL mediated pathway. However, they also recognize by indirect pathway also, in which the self MHC is restricted. In that case, they can't clear out the, or you can say they can't kill the foreign graft cells, because those cells are not expressing self-MHC molecules. In that case, the processing is needed. So this is the complete flowchart. This is the complete diagram of this killing, this rejection. This is the sensitization phase, as you can see. This is the donor dendritic cell from where the graft was, taken. This is the example of allograft, in which kidney is the organ which has been transplanted. This is the donor alloantigen. That means onto this graft, what kind of antigens were present? They are named as donor alloantigens. Okay. This is the recipient dendritic cell. That means the receiver part who have received this organ, the dendritic cell of those recipients. In this case, what would be happening after getting this graft? The alloantigen present onto this graft would be taken up by the dendritic cell of the host body. So as you can see, these donor alloantigens are present inside this dendritic cell. So what would be happening after this thing is done? These alloantigens would be transported to the lymph node. So as you can see, these are the recipient dendritic cell carrying the alloantigen, and this is the donor dendritic cell. It is migrating to lymph node. We also know that in the lymph node, there are many afferent lymphatic vessels, these afferent lymph vessels, and there is only one efferent lymph vessel. So through afferent lymph vessel, these cells would be entering the lymph node. From there, they would be being recognized by different T cells. As you can see, these are alloreactive T lymphocytes. T cells would be activated, they would be proliferating and differentiating into different cell types. As you can see, these are differentiated. These red one are CD4 positive effector T cell. That means they are helper T cells. And these blue ones, these are cytotoxic T lymphocytes. That means CD8 positive effector cells. So once they have proliferated here, the T cells are T effector cells are produced. These cells, with the help of efferent lymphatic vessel, they will transport it back to the site of allograft or to the kidney. So this first step of transport of alloantigens to the lymph node and activation of T cells, this is the part of sensitization phase. When it is transported back to the kidney, this comes in the case of rejection part. So in this case, once they activated effector T cells, they are migrating back to the allograft region. At that time, as you can see, these cells have entered. This is the cytotoxic T lymphocyte. It will directly attack the donor tissue cell. As you can see, this is the donor tissue cell. This is the allografted, this is the cytotoxic T lymphocyte, and it is mediating the killing. This is the killing of target cell. On the other hand, the recipient antigen presenting cells is also activating a cascade of antibody production by producing certain cytokines. This is the T helper cell. This T helper cell is recognizing this antigen and it is producing cytokines so that the graft rejection can be mediated. This is the whole mechanism of allograft rejection, the whole stage. Now the point is the activation of, there is one fate we have discussed, that means the graft rejection mechanism with the help of T lymphocytes. Now there is another pathway in which alloreactive B cells are also involved in mediating the transplant rejection. B cells are mainly those cells that differentiate into plasma cells so that they can produce antibodies. So whenever a particular kind of antibody is produced against self tissue or alloantigen, those are known as alloantibodies. This concept we have already discussed. So antibodies against the graft antigens, they also contribute to rejection. How? Because most of the high affinity autoantibodies that are produced by helper T cell, they activate the alloreactive B cells. So just like a normal immune response, they will start producing many antibodies against that very graft. And this will mediate the effector mechanism. This will activate the effector mechanism in conjunction with complement activation. That means antibodies and complement proteins in a very sequential manner and a coordinated fashion, they will trigger the killing of the graft and they will do the graft rejection. So there were two types, there were three clinical manifestations: hyperacute, acute and chronic. Acute graft rejection is mediated by direct recognition by CD8 positive T cell, and chronic is carried out by CD4 positive T cell. That is why it is being delayed. We will be discussing this thing in detail in our coming slides. This is the direct pathway of graft rejection. This is the indirect one. And there are different fates that how these cells are basically getting activated and rejected. As you can see, this is the antigen presenting cell in the graft. Here it is showing class 1 MHC molecule, class 2. The recognition is being carried out by CD8 positive for the class MHC1 and CD4 positive for the class MHC2. So once the CD8 positive cells, T cells, have recognized this antigen, they will proliferate and they will directly move to the renal blood vessel so that the thrombosis and graft ischemia condition is being established. Along with that, it will bring about the damage to the renal tubule also. On the other hand, in case of helper T cell, if it is proliferating, it is basically secreting certain cytokines, for example, interferon gamma, and it is triggering the delayed type hypersensitivity reaction, that is the type 4 hypersensitivity reaction. In that case, it will activate the macrophages, and these macrophages will start the graft rejection mechanism. This is the direct pathway. On the other hand, in the case of indirect pathway, these graft cells would be processed by the antigen presenting cell. It will be recognized by the helper T cell, and the cascade would remain same for the proliferation. After that, the CD4 positive helper T cell, it will activate B lymphocytes so that the antibody mediated pathway can be triggered. In that case, these B lymphocytes would differentiate into plasma cell. As you can see here, this plasma cell will start producing specific antibody against this graft antigen, and those antibody will attack on the renal blood vessel and the graft would be rejected. So the main bottom line is the acceptance as well as the rejection of any kind of transplant or any kind of graft is determined by 5 main things. The first is class 1 and class 2 MHC proteins that are present on the donor cells. Second is both CD4 positive and CD8 positive T cells, that means helper T cell as well as cytotoxic T cells. Dendritic cells, they also play a role, as I told you that in the sensitization phase, how these dendritic cells are going for the processing. Then difference in the minor histocompatibility loci, these are the other other transplantation antigens that plays a role. And ABO blood group, that means the blood group antigens, they also play a major role. These are the 5 major factors that are basically triggering either the acceptance or the rejection of transplant. Now the point is, whenever a human is suffering from any kind of disease or disorder that may happen due to some defect in the organ or organ failure or tissue injury, in that case, the only remedy is to go for the transplantation. Either you go for the transplant of organs so that you can replace the defective organs with the, you know, fully functional one, or you can go for some surgical technique so as to repair the tissue in case the tissue grafting is possible in that case. But in that case, whenever you go for this, there are 3 clinical outcomes. You can say 3 clinical manifestation of graft rejection, that in what time span the graft would be rejected. So according to the time of activation and type of effector mechanism that is mediating the rejection, there are 3 main outcomes: hyperacute, acute, and chronic. First is hyperacute. If after getting a transplant, the rejection is happening within hours, you can say within 24 hours, that is known as hyperacute rejection. Because in that case, the thrombotic occlusion of the graft vasculature is involved. That means that normally this process is triggered within the minutes that you have, you know, grafted the thing. Because the host blood vessels, they get joined to the graft vessels, and the pre-existing bodies that are already present in the recipient body, they will directly attack the graft cell. So because of that, the response that is coming, that is very immediate. You can say the host body is already containing the preformed antibodies against that very graft. So once you have grafted that tissue, the response would be within minutes to hours that it will be cleared from the body. It will be dead. So this hyperacute rejection, it is taking place within 24 hours of transplantation, in which the main responsible thing is serum antibodies, that is preformed antibodies that react to the foreign MHC molecules that are present onto the surface of graft. And along with that, it also activates the complement system. That means this antibody mediated and complement mediated pathway is the main key player for the hyperacute rejection. Because of that, the inrush of neutrophils and lymphocytes is happening at the site of at the site of grafting, so that the blood clotting can be done there. So this is a mechanism. This is the pre-existing antibodies that are carried in the kidney graft. Already the antibodies against that very graft is present. So what is happening whenever you are going for the grafting, these preformed antibodies, they will bind to the antigens of the renal capillaries. Once they are bound, they will activate the complement proteins. So these complement proteins will basically, the cleavage of these complement proteins will attract all the neutrophils to the site. So these are the neutrophils. These neutrophils then would be taking the part, and they will release certain lytic enzymes, perforins, GRAN enzymes. If you people remember in the previous lectures also, we have discussed that the neutrophil mediated killing is basically triggered by the lytic enzymes, that is perforin that create the pores and GRAN enzymes that basically mediate the killing. So this neutrophil lytic enzymes, they will start destroying these endothelial cells, and all the platelets that are present in the blood, they will start accumulating at this site and will cause the vascular blockage. If the vascular blockage is there, where the graft would not be getting blood supply so that it can, survive. If the blood supply is not there, that tissue, that cell would be veered off, or that will turn to a necrotic tissue. But the point is, we are talking about serum antibodies. From where these serum antibodies are coming? Suppose you have already had an exposure to this graft. In that case, our body has already prepared the antibodies against them. Now, the second outcome is acute rejection. This is basically a two-step process. And this is a old-fashioned immune response that normally triggered within 2 weeks of transplantation. Suppose you have got the organ transplant, but the transplantation, it will take time. You can say within 2 to 3 weeks, because all the macrophages, lymphocytes, they will take time to reach to the tissue, to reach to the site where the organ was transplanted. Once they have reached there, then they will trigger the cytotoxic mediated pathway, complement pathway, and the graft cell rejection would be happening. In this case, the 2 week delay is basically indicating the T helper cell activation time. As you can see, this is the antigen presenting cell. It is presenting the antigen to T helper cell. It is producing cytokines, interleukin 2, interleukin 4, interleukin 6, so that the different T lymphocytes can be formed. As you can see, on one side it is activating B cells so that it can produce antibodies. On another side, it is differentiating into CD4 positive cytotoxic T lymphocyte, CD4 CD8 positive cytotoxic T lymphocyte, and delayed type hypersensitivity cell, T cell. So all of these things in a very coordinated fashion, they then act onto the graft and they reject it. But this complete step of this complete proliferation into all these cells, it will take around a 2 week span. That is why we call it as acute rejection. So that means acute rejection, it happens within the weeks. It is a process of injury to the graft parenchymal and blood cells that is mediated by alloreactive T cells and the antibodies that have been formed against that very cell. It is happening in two stages, that is acute cellular rejection and acute antibody mediated rejection, because both the B cell and T cells are playing the role. The principal mechanism that is involved in the first stage is inflammation. That is normally triggered because of the cytokines released by the helper T cells, and it triggers the CTL mediated pathway. And in case of acute antibody mediated recognition, in that case, autoantibodies that are produced in response to the LO antigens, they basically cause the endothelial injury and thrombosis reaction that result in the graft rejection. So this is a complete pathway of it. acute rejection. This is the endothelial cell, blood vessel. This is the allo antigen. For example, you can say blood group antigen, the circulating allo antigen specific antibody. As you can see, this is the Y-shaped structure that is recognizing this antigen. Once it is bound, it is activating the complement protein also, and it is causing the endothelial damage. And it will result in a condition known as inflammation and thrombosis. Second is, this one is the hyperacute. This one is the acute one, in which this is the antigen presenting cell that is being recognized by the helper T cell, and it is releasing cytokines. These are the parenchymal cell of the graft onto which this cytotoxic T lymphocyte is basically attaching. So here the T cells are also recognizing these antigens, and antibodies are also doing the same thing. So this is a you can say a coordinated effort of T lymphocytes as well as the antibodies, so that the rejection can be happened. But this thing is certainly delayed. Last is chronic rejection. Chronic rejection, first of all, we need to understand what is chronic rejection. In this case, suppose a graft is is protected from an immediate rejection response. In that case, that rejection can be happening you can say within months or years. In that case, because the reason is, sometimes when we go for the grafting, in that case some doctors administer or go for immunosuppressive drugs. So this tissue typing and immunosuppressive drugs, they decrease the likelihood of this chronic rejection. But it has a very long way to go, because if we can't manage the rejection, then another transplant is needed. And of course, due to the memory and specificity of our adaptive immune response, the subsequent reaction or subsequent rejection would be very fast, very strong. So as a therapy for acute rejection, this chronic rejection is sometime happening, because in that case we are administering some immunosuppressives. So it will take around months to year, and there would be effect of many mechanisms in it. For example, cell mediated deposition of antibodies, formation of antigen antibody complex. So all of these, they basically trigger the chronic rejection or chronic outcome. Now, important point is, having talked about the different stages, what is the mechanism, and what are the clinical manifestations, the point is, there are certain zones of immunological privilege. That means there are certain organs of our body that are privileged sites. So the transplants, if they are happening in those sites, they are found to be highly successful. For example, there are few blood vessels in the cornea that have a very low rate of corneal graft rejection. You can say around 20%, in 20% of cases, only the rejection was observed. So there has been, the scientists have achieved many success in transplanting fetal pig neural tissue into the brains of Parkinson's disease patients, so that the Parkinson's disease can be treated. But there is one important mechanism also, that is graft versus host reaction. So whenever you are going for grafting, this thing is known as GVHR, abbreviated form. When the grafted tissue, it already have some mature T cell, or you can say activated T cells, they will start attacking the host tissue also. You can say this is the side effect that will lead to a condition GVHR. This problem is mainly observed whenever you are going for bone marrow transplant. In that case, the only solution is either to treat the bone marrow, so all the mature T cells are eliminated. Another is either use the autologous bone marrow for the transplantation, or you use umbilical cord blood, so that the reaction can be minimized, because the lymphocytes from the donor are normally carried by the organ into the body of the graft recipient. Suppose you are taking the organ from one organism and then you are transporting it. The lymphocyte, the mature T cells, are present inside that organ that will also be transplanted to the recipient. So if the recipient is already immunocompromised or the immunity is quite weak, in that case, these foreign lymphocytes can attack his tissue, because the recipient's immune system is already very weak. It is not in the proper stage to provide protection. In that case, sometimes you must have observed, after organ transplantation, there are some side effects. For example, somebody is experiencing skin rashes, somebody is having some gastrointestinal problem, the final stage is organ failure and then death. that can be fatal also, but there are some minor consequences also. So this graft versus host disease or rejection is normally observed in the case of certain kinds of organ transplant, for example, liver, spleen, and bone marrow. So this normally happens in the special case of immunocompetent tissue that lead to a situation known as runt disease, in which these are the symptoms: anemia, lymphoid atrophy, fatality, diarrhea. So all these things happen. But whenever you are going for transplantation, there are many barriers to it. There are many difficulties that are, you know, faced, posed by the immune system. The first is, first of all, before going to transplant, you need to have MHC matching done. Then after you are doing some repeat graft recipient, they can reject new organ faster as compared to the previous one. However, the organ transplantation is the only remedy if an organ is failed. But many transplantable organs, they are very, the shortage is there, because we have to get those organs that are showing compatibility. So how you can prevent the rejection? So if you are going for a grafting, in that case, the first thing is general immunosuppressive therapy, such as you can use some mitotic inhibitors so that T cell proliferation and differentiation can be inhibited. You can use some anti-inflammatory agents such as corticosteroids. You can use some fungal metabolites that can act as immunosuppressive agents. You can use some total lymphocyte irradiation mechanisms also. You can use some specific treatments also. For example, monoclonal antibody, in which anti-CD3 you can use so as to decrease the mature T cells. You can also use many antibodies that can act as an adhesion molecules. You can also use antibody against the cytokines, for example, anti-interleukin cytokines. This is the basically site of action of various these things. This is the transplanted tissue. These are the co-stimulators, CD40, CD40L. This would be cleared only in case of anti-CD40L. So by administering all these things, you can basically go for this clinical transplantation protection. However, there are many clinical tests, many laboratory-based tests that are available before going into this, you can say, just a moment. So these laboratory tests are either ABO blood typing, tissue typing, that is HLA matching. We have also discussed this thing in yesterday's lecture also, lymphocytotoxicity test, MLR test, which we normally do. First of all, we go for the test, for many tests for the donor and recipient, for example, blood typing, ABO compatibility, microcytotoxicity test, MLR test, in which the patients, they are the most commonly used test is MLR test, that is T helper cell activation. This is a procedure, mixed blood cell. This is a donor, this is a another donor. In that case, we will be taking the mononuclear cells from the two donors in the tissue culture. We will be mixing it. After mixing it, we will be basically observing the response, that whether these antigens are being recognized by cytotoxic cell or helper T cells. If cytotoxic T cells are being proliferated, they will lyse the cell. Along with that helper T cell, they will go for the cytokine secretion and they will produce antibodies. Then another test is cross matching. This is also a very important test for the compatibility testing, that normally is done in the case of solid organ transfer, in which the fluorochrome labeled microbeads are basically loaded with the specific HLA molecules. As you can see, this is the anti-HLA body in the recipient serum, that whatever the patient would be having the organ transplant, the antibody present in that. In that case, the Luminex bead is taken, which is fluorescently labeled, and onto the surface HLA antigen is, you know, bind. So whenever you mix these things, so these things, after binding with the secondary antibody, they will give fluorescence. So this is another thing. This is a tissue typing method, in which this is a donor cell, recipient cell. You are taking the alleles, you are mixing it with the help of antibodies, and these are complement proteins. Either the cell will become leaky or they will go for the, you know, dye will be taken up. As we have discussed about trypan blue method, in which the main intensity was determined by trypan blue. More the dye uptaken, that means more are the antigens present against them. So this is the complete flow chart that how we perform this experiment, microcytotoxicity. So if you want to prolong the allograft survival after getting some allograft thing, you can use some immunosuppressants, for example, cyclosporine, tacromolis, azathioprine, rapamycin, corticosteroids, or some anti-co-stimulators. So this MHC matching also prevent rejection, because along with the MHC and as well as the minor histocompatibility antigens, they are the main key players. So in that case, we also need immune suppression. This is the most important organ transplantation, that is kidney. So in this case, immunosuppressive therapy, the non-specific approach is highly successful, because there are many drugs that interfere with the immune response and that lead to the rejection of donor tissue. So because if we decrease the immune responsiveness of the recipient body, you can have a graft acceptance. So whatever the current therapies are available using multiple drugs in low doses, however, all of these drugs are basically derived from fungi, because fungi are the natural sources, are rich natural sources of many bioactive molecules. So these treatments that produce immunodeficiency specific to the donor alloantigens, they are the artificial treatment so as to go for the immunosuppressors. You can also go for monoclonal antibodies that can block the T cell activation and extend the life of transplanted organs. These are the drugs that how they are acting. Small molecule drugs, we can either go for depleting antibodies by using these anti-co-stimulators. You can go for fusion proteins also. Last problem is xenotransplantation, because we have discussed the mechanism that are involved in the allograft. Xenotransplantation was the transfer of the tissue from one species to another. So it is normally the implantation of animal tissue in humans. So there are different type of tissues that we can transfer. However, using animals for organ transport, this is a new source of organs, because there is shortage of human donors. There are many immune restrictions also. Sometimes closely related species are shown to have much success, so there is some risk also. However, these are some clinical aspects of it, because we have already achieved much of the success in case of kidney, heart, liver, bone marrow. However, the earliest xenotransplantation that was done in the case of when the chimpanzee kidney was, transplanted to a human, it was happened in the year 1964. Then after that, era was marked in which many transplants have been carried out. For example, two liver transplant was carried out in 1993. Pigs even have been transplanted. But there are certain problems, that is, with the immunosuppression. If you are using some immunosuppressive therapy so as to, promote the graft acceptance, the foreignness of animal tissue sometimes provokes a vigorous immune response from the recipient. And all the viruses and diseases which is having no effect on animals, they come into picture. So all of these things are very, playing the important role. The out of the privileged sites, fetus survives. Fetus survival is also very important. For example, the placenta that act as an immunological barrier whenever you are going for it. MHC that are present in a very low density in the fetus cells. In that case, there is a protein known as alpha-fetoprotein in the blood that basically provide the help. In this, the cornea is also survived because of the lack of vascularity, because the similar type of antigens are present. Then is bone marrow. In case of bone marrow, there are many attempts in which these cells have been used around 60 years, and you have. So all these bone transplantation have been explored since World War, and they have been used for treating many blood vessels, severe immunodeficiency diseases, leukemia diseases. So this type of transplant is currently being employed as gene therapy. However, there are some stem cells also that have been used for transplants, for example, peripheral blood stem cells. You must have heard about it, that you can store your stem cells and you can go for the treatment whenever you require for it. So this is again the same scenario in which you can go for it. So when we talk about fetus, why the fetus is not rejected? In that case, the progesterone hormone that is being produced in the mother body that acts as an immunosuppressive, because the placenta also express the site of FAS ligand. So that FAS ligand, it also promote the acceptance of it, so that the fetus can't be rejected from inside the mother. So the what are the solutions to it? The animals that are bred with the human histocompatibility genes or who are showing some similarity with the human antigens. And there are, however, there have been some other transgenic organs also that produce certain proteins that can prevent the destruction by these complement-mediated pathways. So now I'll be summarizing it. Graft antigens, they are recognized by host lymphocytes. Then either the cell-mediated immune response or antibody immune response is the main key player in it, and with the specificity and memory are the main things. These are some few further links on which you can get a detailed information about it. These are the MCQs that are already uploaded on the LMS for your reference pertaining to this lecture. Thank you so much for listening.